My name is Jim Levitt. I'm the manager of land conservation programs at the Lincoln Institute of Land Policy, and I also serve as the director of the program on conservation innovation at the Harvard Forest, which is part of Harvard University. It is a great pleasure, it is an honor for me to have the opportunity to introduce Jean Hocker back to Boston. Jean is no stranger to Boston. She graduated from Boston University, and the intelligence and wit and charm that she gained there lives to this very day.
It was out of girl school, wasn't it?
I don't think so. And I want to note that Steve Small is also here. He is also a recipient of the Kingsbury Browne Award. Without Jean, there would be no Land Trust Alliance as we know it today. Jean is an essential part of the story of the growth of the land trust movement in the United States. She is an exceptionally deserving recipient of the Kingsbury Browne Award. Indeed, as you will see in just a second, she helped to invent the Kingsbury Browne Fellowship at the Lincoln Institute of Land Policy and the Kingsbury Browne Award at the Land Trust Alliance. Her story in conservation, as I understand it from her husband Phil, who is in the back of the room with us today, began in 1972 when Phil took Jean on a camping trip in Jackson, Wyoming. And as the story goes, she both fell in love with Phil and with Jackson Hole and the surrounding Tetons and environment. In fact, Jean and Phil and their children moved to Jackson. They integrated themselves into the community there. Jean took a job with a planning agency to think about land protection, and in 1980 was instrumental in creating the Jackson Hole Land Trust, which is, I understand it, is one of the very first land trusts in the Rocky Mountain West in the United States. In 1987, after putting a distinct mark on the map of that corner of Wyoming, Jean was attracted to Washington, D.C., where she became the chief executive officer of the Land Trust Alliance. She was the third or fourth person to run what was then known as the LTA, now known as the Alliance, before that known as the Land Trust Exchange. And she did an extraordinary job. She was particularly known for her entrepreneurship, for her courage, and her very sharp intelligence in navigating this fledgling organization into a national force. No question that she had passion for land conservation, not only in a particular locality, but at the national level. And her drive to make land conservation a permanent part of the American policy landscape led her and others who worked alongside her to create the standards and practices which are still a hallmark of the Land Trust Alliance members, those land trusts which collectively today have protected something like 50 million acres of land in the United States. She got quite a bit of guidance from a gentleman named Kingsbury Browne. And here I want to cut to just a little bit of video, which was recorded prior to the time that Jean knew, although some of us on the phone call knew, that Jean was going to be a recipient of the Kingsbury Browne Award. So this is a recording that we took with Jean's knowledge on the telephone in March 2014.
To understand the impact he had, you have to understand some of the characteristics that drew countless people into his circle and realm. He was a wise mentor to countless fledgling land trust professionals and organizations. I don't think we'll ever know the breadth of the impact on individuals that he had. He had an insatiable curiosity He was a teacher, a writer, a scholar, but also a doer and a man of action. He had a marvelous wit, which I hope will be captured in the video. And he had a real faith in land trusts that land trusts are going to evolve into something really important in this country.
Okay. We're going to come back to this clip in just a second. Jean joined, because of her distinguished service at the Land Trust Alliance, the board of directors of the Lincoln Institute of Land Policy in 1998 and served here until 2006. She was a distinct voice on the board in support of land conservation programs, for which I thank you very, very much. In 2005, I believe, Kingsbury Browne passed away. Jean, really in consultation with Armando Carbonell, who was in the audience, and I believe Peter Stein was part of that conversation, helped to create an award that would honor Kingsbury's memory. Here I will go to a second clip. And you will see here a picture of the young Jean Hocker in 1990 with the entire staff of the Land Trust Alliance.
We just kind of fed off of each other, the excitement of, oh my gosh, this is going on all over the country and we can learn from one another. And it was Kingsbury Browne who set the groundwork and built the foundation for Ovid.
It was his vision, it was his doing, and out of that came the Land Trust Exchange, now known as the Land Trust Alliance.
When Kingsbury died in 2005, I and I know others wanted to do something to honor Kingsbury and to keep that spirit of his alive. We worked together to create an award.
Its purpose was to honor and recognize leaders who embody the characteristics of Kingsbury Browne.
The point is that Jean and Armando and Peter and several other people thought that it would be fitting and proper to give an award every year to a person who embodied Kingsbury's spirit and his contribution to the land trust movement that he helped to create. We have, in the last 10 years at the Lincoln Institute, had the privilege to spend time with Darby Bradley of the Vermont Land Trust, Mark Ackleson of the Iowa Natural Heritage Foundation, all people who have been indispensable in the growth of the land trust movement, Lori Wayburn from the Pacific Forest Trust, Jamie Williams from the Nature Conservancy, Jay Espy from the Elmina B. Sewell Foundation and the Maine Coast Heritage Trust, Audrey Rust from Post, Peter Stein from the Lime Timber Company, Larry Keeter from the Colorado Cattlemen's Land Trust, and in 2014-2015, in the same year that we had the chance to make this film about Kingsbury Browne, we were honored to bring up to the podium at the Land Trust rally Jean Hocker as the recipient of the Kingsbury Browne Award. Now, Jean has written a very thoughtful paper and has a presentation to share with all of you about not this past that I've just gone over, but about the generation and the passing of the torch from this generation to the next in the leadership of the Land Trust Alliance. So, Jean, the podium is yours.
Really, thank you, Jim. I think I should stop right here because I don't want to spoil the marvelous introduction that you gave me, Jim. Thank you, and thank you. I see a lot of old friends here, and a lot of people who've been instrumental in the Land Trust Alliance are instrumental, and some new faces, and that's always good. That's kind of what my whole project was about. In thinking about what I would want to do for the Kingsbury Browne Fellowship that goes along with the award, I found myself first looking back on earlier days, because I go back a long way in the land trust movement, and then I started thinking about how things have changed, but I was also most interested to look at what lies ahead for land trusts, the challenges, the skills, the future leaders are going to need, how senior leaders and emerging leaders can share the knowledge and experience. As most of you know, the land trust movement in the United States dates back to the closing years of the 19th century. The changing nature of the work with its constant new challenges, sometimes a benefit, sometimes a, a challenge, but the opportunities to bring people together around the land, they have almost all mentioned they got to work with such great, compassionate people. The satisfaction, a lot of them love doing deals, which is just kind of fun, even though it's hard. And the knowledge that they're saving land for future generations. You know, no surprises there, but it's the same, whether you're 70, whether you're 30, you know, it's what attracts and keeps people in this movement. And then one of the interesting differences I found was in the career expectations. When the senior leaders got into this, they had no expectation. They didn't know what they were going to do, really. They just seemed like a cool thing to do. And most of the senior leaders I interviewed for this had made their careers with one or two organizations. They're known for their affiliation with one or two organizations, but the emerging leaders I interviewed had already in their lives worked for one or two land trusts before their current job. They all plan to stay in the field, which is very heartening, these younger leaders. But many envision working in a different organization, maybe in a different capacity, maybe at the national level, maybe in a funding foundation capacity. So they see a long career ahead. Whereas I think when we started out, we just said, oh, this is what we're doing now. This is very cool and fun. And who knows what's going to happen next. So how do they view each other, these two generations? Well, senior leaders are really impressed with the intelligence and the energy and the ideas of younger leaders. And emerging leaders have huge respect for the vision and accomplishments of the generation before them. But not surprisingly, each generation has its own perspectives as well. Both generations acknowledge that the now senior leaders in their earlier years operated with fewer expectations about professionalism and structure than is expected today. Perhaps as a result, older leaders tend to see younger ones as less scrappy, that's a quote from somebody, more risk averse, maybe less creative than they think they were, the seniors were when they were younger. They see that senior leaders see the younger ones operating with more responsibility, but maybe less passion. Now that's just a few people. It's not meant to be, universal, but that's what I heard. And at least one younger leader concurred and said, well, we're probably more sophisticated and professional, but maybe we have less entrepreneurial hustle. And that's, sort of captures some of it. A lot of senior leaders think that the greater bureaucracy in today's land trust has produced fewer generalists and more people who work in silos or in specialties, who depend on technology, sometimes at the expense of personal relationship building. As one senior leader said, land trust leaders are more sophisticated now. They have a lot of technology, like GIS systems. But some are time wasters, he said. Maybe, sometimes the back of a bar napkin works just as well as elaborate mapping, close quote, and builds a personal relationship by sitting at the bar with a napkin, too, I should say. Some emerging leaders see older leaders as kind of stuck in their ways. This is probably not unique to land trust. This has been going on since the beginning of time, of course. But they say some of the older leaders are stuck in their ways and maybe even stuck in their top-level jobs. There's occasionally an undercurrent among the younger leaders of, wishing some of the older guys and gals would get out of the way to make room for the younger leaders to advance. But nevertheless, as I'll talk about later, the emerging leaders do think that seniors have a lot of wisdom and impact and experience to impart, and they have ideas of ways to make that happen. So I'm going to take just a minute here to talk about the sort of evolution, although Jim covered a lot of that, and that's fine. But there's Kingsbury again, and the senior leaders, this is a great quote that I want to give you a minute to read because it kind of captures it all. For senior leaders, especially those who started out in the 70s or early 80s, before there was a land trust alliance, and I was one of those, learning the job was really a bootstrap process. For many of these earlier folks, the skills grew largely from just learning by doing, trying things, making mistakes, you know, talking to other folks. Some of them are in this room and maybe can attest to that. The Nature Conservancy and Trust for Public Lands, who at that time didn't consider themselves to be land trusts because they were too big. Land trusts were the little guys. But they were a big help in some cases. They really did impart a lot of help, but there was no formal structured way to learn. And some of them, in the mid-Atlantic in New England, Kingsbury Browne provided legal help, or legal care, as he always called it, to a group of land trusts in that part of the country. As Jim mentioned, I think in 1981, Kingsbury actually convinced or urged the Lincoln Institute to convene some of these land trusts from across the country to see what was going on. And it was the first ever national gathering of land trust leaders, some of whom had never before met face to face. I was privileged to be there. Peter Stein was there. I don't know, Chip was there, you know. And yes, Russ was there too. So you can correct me if I'm wrong, but it was the first ever national gathering, and a sense of common purpose arose, and participants realized the needs for professionalism, communication, taking unified positions on policy issues that affect land conservation, and marketing land trust to the general public as a positive social tool. This is right out of the proceedings of that seminal 1981 gathering. They also identified a great need for building stronger institutions. So a lot of these things are still familiar stuff going on in the land trust world. And as Jim said, from that gathering grew the Land Trust Exchange and later renamed the Land Trust Alliance. And now it's hard to imagine a world without the Alliance and others. Land trusts today are operating in a very different world. But some of the things, they still conserve open space, they still acquire land and easements, they're still concerned about strengthening their organizations, they're still concerned a lot about funding and building community support. But there's been a lot of change and growth. And among those, the growth of land trust numbers is leveling off. There were about 400 land trusts in 1981, and in 2005, which is the latest Land Trust Alliance census that has been published, I gather the newest one will be published this fall, but I don't have the benefit of those figures. But between 400 in 1981 and over 1,600 by 2005, so it was an era of tremendous growth in the numbers of organizations. And we used to boast proudly that a new land trust is formed every week. Hooray! And then we began to look and said, a new land trust is formed every week. That may not be such a great thing after all. And a lot of them were too small. They didn't have the resources. They were, you know, they just, it was not, that kind of growth was not sustainable. And so some mergers took place, some went out of business, it just never thrived, but the ones that remained got stronger and stronger, and there was a great growth in professionalism. As Jim mentioned, in 1989, the Land Trust Alliance developed, with land trusts, the standards and practices, which are still pretty much intact today. There have been some changes, and there are going to be some changes coming up in the next couple of years in the standards and practices, which is a good thing. But this sort of said, here's what you need to do to be a land trust, and that had never happened before. And then in 2006 was the advent of accreditation for land trusts, major development. And now 342 land trusts are accredited. That number is, of course, growing all the time. Some have been renewed after 5 years. There's a big change in emphasis on stewardship of land and easements. Two or three decades ago, we were so busy getting land protected as development marched across the landscape that, you know, we thought, well, yeah, someday we're going to take care of these things. But, you know, the emphasis right now has got to be on getting land protected. And we thought, that's for the future. And now while land trusts are still very busy protecting new land, they are also really aware of the responsibility, for the most part, to take care of the easements they have, to manage the land responsibly that they own, and to understand that younger leaders really seem to understand, the ones I talk to, that this is a huge responsibility. Well, there are more programs, there's more staff, more management, more fundraising. All of these are big concerns now as land trusts grow and build their programs and take on more responsibilities. And there is a big focus on what land trusts, who now own and manage and have some control over a lot of land, why? Who's it for? What's it for? This quote captures, from one of the emerging leaders, really captures it. And we'll talk more about that. But the power of land trusts is they now control a great deal of land. The question is, what do they do with it? How does all this relate to people's lives? And today's land trusts and into the future, land trusts see this as a big responsibility, both ethically and morally, but also, frankly, for the sustainability of land trusts and land conservation. So this is this leads to a discussion, and I ask both generations, what are the challenges that you see ahead for the land trust movement? Here's what came up most often, not necessarily in priority order, but achieving sustainable funding. That probably came up more and more because of the growing responsibilities of land trusts. It's always been a problem. These are NGOs, after all. They're small NGOs. Of course, money's a problem, but they have very serious responsibilities lasting for a very, very long time, and the programs are growing, and they're trying to reach out to more parts of the community, and it's expensive. And raising, I mean, land trusts that I talk to are very, the younger leaders especially, are very concerned about being stretched too thin. And they always have this struggle between doing the work now that needs to be done and preparing for the future. And they don't know how much they're going to be able to grow, because they really don't know how sustainable it's going to be from a funding standpoint. This speaks for itself. Defending and enforcing conservation easements. Yeah, the last census, 2010, census of the Land Trust Alliance said that land trusts hold over 9 million acres under conservation easement, and soon they're going to be in the hands of new generations of owners that didn't give the easement or sell the easement, put it on their land. The Alliance had, so that's going to lead to more stewardship obligation, more defense, especially of conservation easements. The vulnerability was discussed back in the 1981 consultation here, but it's coming to home to roost right now and in the future. A huge step was taken by the Alliance in 2011 with the establishment of Terra Firma, which is a charitable risk pool owned by participating land trusts that insures their members against the legal costs of defending easements and land. And boy, do I give my successors at the Land Trust Alliance huge credit for getting that up and running and functioning. We were talking about it when I was there, but it's the next folks that actually made it happen. But that doesn't cover all the costs of monitoring and enforcement, doesn't address easements held by non-participating land trusts or land trusts that can't meet the qualifications. So it's still a big issue. Defining this community conservation is also, interestingly, a big issue. There, as I said, leaders are so serious, younger leaders especially, well, all of them actually, about embracing a broader audience and making land conservation more relevant to more people and more segments of society. But they're less certain about how to do it in ways that meet their mission, their culture, their capacity. As one younger leader said, I hope we don't try to create a definition of community conservation. We shouldn't try to put it in a box. So some of the issues, I mean, the Land Trust Alliance says itself says that community conservation is not primarily driven by scenic or ecological concerns. And yet, as the one to the right at the top says, senior leader said there are a lot of tensions among my board and staff and supporters about mission drift. My board asks whether we are about nature or people. They fear a slippery slope. These differences are not, he said, generational, but some younger people are the staunchest defenders of natural area protection. Well, natural area protection and community conservation aren't necessarily opposed to one another. It just is how you define what the natural areas are and what they're used for. But it's in transition right now, and Land Trust sees this as a challenge ahead to figure out what does it mean. You can see that we used to think that the land protecting natural areas, some people thought was elitist. Just for the, you know, we fought that for a long time, that notion of elitism in the land trust world. But as one senior leader said, protecting wild places isn't elitist. These places are for people too. We just need to do both. And by both, he meant reach out to more people and also protect some wild places. So it's an issue. I mean, it's an exciting issue. It's a timely issue. It's very exciting, and we'll see what happens in the next 10 years. It means different things to different land trusts, and it's going to play out, I think, in the next decade with these younger leaders. Many people talked about attracting the best and the brightest as a big challenge ahead for land trusts. And some of the things that were mentioned as potential obstacles, work-life balance came up all the time. really, all the time. And as one younger leader said, I'm better at shielding my staff from overwork than at looking after myself, which I think probably we all can kind of recognize. The need to pay off student loans, the small size of land trust generally that limits advancement within one organization. Benefits came up as a hindrance, especially health insurance and family leave. Which are not equal to many for-profit opportunities which the best and the brightest could have available to them. The lack of time and money to provide support, mentoring, and training within land trusts, and it was interesting to me, this came up several times, the lack of desire among many to take on real leadership roles because it was pointed out a lot of these very bright, younger, compassionate, dedicated leaders, they love doing land deals. You know, they love being out there on the land. They don't really want to raise money and manage personnel and take, you know, do the finances and take on the roles of a CEO of a land trust. And as someone said, they want to be out in the land or just want to do deals. We need to make executive director positions seem more attractive to them. So I don't know. Also, I must mention that there is a strong desire in looking at the best and brightest to add people of color. This has been an issue in the land trust movement since I got into it. It's certainly an issue in the environmental movement generally, except maybe in the social justice branch of it. And it's still an issue. There's a strong desire, not a lot of great success at land trusts. They recognize that land conservation isn't necessarily a priority yet for people of color. They have, and they're hoping, the land trusts are, that outreach and partnerships with broader segments of the community, working in urban neighborhoods and inner city schools and so forth, may help attract people, establishing relationships with historically black colleges, including internships and fellowships, might also help. But nobody had the solution, but it is a big challenge. I next asked about resources and skills that land trust leaders are going to need in the future to meet these challenges. And both generations pretty much agreed on what's going to be needed ahead. These quotes, I think, are not focusing on the technical skills. They're not focusing on some of the legal skills and the kinds of things that we know land trust leaders need. And focusing on kind of person. And many said, you know, too many applicants now just have a natural resources background. One of them said, I have applicants, and this is a younger leader, who can identify every species on an acre of land. But, and then he went on to say, their educations are far too heavily tilted toward the natural world. They need to have more practical experience. What I need, I love this, are people who can manage complex projects, earn the trust of others, think critically, and hopefully write a complete sentence, which I loved. And this was a very bright young guy. He's not an old fogey. People are looking at the skills ahead. We're gonna need things like fundraising skills, management skills. A lot of the younger leaders said they wanted management skills because they find themselves in organizations that are growing. They might have 5 or 6 people on their staffs, maybe more now. You know, that's a big job. And they management came up a lot among emerging leaders. Communication skills, cultural competency, and community organizing skills. Collaboration and partnership skills came up a lot. Personal relationship building skills, especially for the younger people who have grown up depending on electronic communications. And not surprisingly, this comment came up a lot from the senior leaders who said, you know, got to talk to people. You got to get out there and sit around the kitchen table still. Political skills and priority setting and time management skills came up also. What does this mean for the generational transition that's coming up now? As we think about these challenges, we have to think about who's going to lead them. What skills do they need? As the senior leaders begin to wind down their careers, emerging leaders move up to take their place, it's critical that leadership transition be accomplished smoothly and as productively as possible, because a lot of it's going to take place in the next 5 or 10 years. And that's going to require both deliberate planning for leadership succession and effectively capturing the wisdom, I hope, of some of the senior leaders wherever that seems to be appropriate. One senior leader noted that accreditation is one of the best ways an organization can prepare for transition, but it also is going to require senior leaders who are ready to let go and younger professionals who are ready to step up. And right now, although a few organizations have adopted formal succession plans and some others are, so they're thinking about it, succession planning doesn't appear to be very high on people's organizational priority lists. It does appear to be the exception. And these are small groups, so that is, I don't find that very surprising. But because they're small, we have to think about succession as a movement-wide issue, not just an organizational issue. We have to prepare for it throughout the land trust movement. The Land Trust Alliance, I know, has provided some guidance in magazine articles, in rally workshops, other learning resources, but I think the next steps might now include more detailed examples of actual succession plans that land trusts have put in place, and as well as other small and medium-sized organizations, because this isn't unique to land trusts. We need to couple that, I think, with an examination of why some leadership successions are successful while others turn into problems. Yeah, really delve in a little bit more to what does this mean and why does it work and why doesn't it work? If you look at what people want to learn from each other and looking at the experiences, this is what younger leaders told me, the emerging leaders. They are looking for a sense of history, both about their own organizations, and somebody said, you know, why did we do that project, you know, 15 years ago? I don't understand why we, you know, why we did some of this stuff in this organization. What problems were we trying to address? But also history about the land trust community as a whole. How did land trusts come about? How did they become a movement? Changes, kinds of things we're talking about here. They want to know how to manage stress and uncertainty. They want to know how to be better managers. They want to know the value of patience and the long view and how to handle setbacks and deal with mistakes and that it's okay to make mistakes. How to successfully relate, this came up often too, and make the best use of their boards of directors. Ways to become better problem solvers and practical approaches to fundraising and sustaining growing operations. Inevitable, always. Senior leaders, as I said earlier, cited the need for younger leaders to recognize the importance of building relationships, personal relationships through regular face-to-face communications. As one said, land conservation is primarily a people business. And this is one of the ways that land trust leaders feel they, senior leaders feel they can best make contributions to the younger leaders. Well, how does this get passed on? A lot of ideas came up, mostly from the younger generation. Senior leaders said, we'd like to pass on what we know, but we have to be asked. We really don't want to intrude and impose ourselves. And that came up quite often. Most of these ideas came from the emerging leaders. Mentoring of some kind is the way that most emerging leaders said they learn best. A lot of it goes on informally, as it always has in this movement. But several people suggested more formal arrangements where younger and older leaders could be paired up and maybe, you know, based on similarities of life situations, a young woman leader who has kids paired with an older woman who's been through all that, or a younger leader who's dealing with a lot of growth in the organization being paired up with somebody who's been through that kind of growth. Something formal, maybe a year, maybe where you check in frequently or periodically with each other, get together once or twice. It's nobody has the answer, but also creating opportunities to share stories and case studies. They wanted informal opportunities to kick back with some of their older peers and just talk about some of this stuff. They made mistakes, we make mistakes, you know, how do you deal with it? It's okay. Let's hear some of the face-to-face opportunities. One interviewer suggested a story corps for conservationists. Intergenerational discussion groups around specific topics or challenges. And along with this comes just creating opportunities for the two generations to work together on real-life problems. Working committees, advisory groups, task force that are making recommendations that need to be answered. And if you sit down with other people of other generations and work together, it's a real learning experience. Nurturing future generation leaders through internships, fellowships, and apprenticeships. And here, one model, but certainly not the only one, is the program that Colorado Open Lands has held, a fellowship program since 1999, where they provide training and practical working experience and have now to some 45 young people who've just graduated with recent graduate degrees. They're two-year positions, they're funded privately through individuals and foundations, but you can see a lot of variations of that kind of program where young people, fresher out of college now than some of these emerging leaders, could really step in and work and get training. And I'm a big fan of meaningful fellowships and apprenticeships. Developing, while the Land Trust Alliance does a lot to train, a really wonderful job of training leaders, younger leaders, all leaders, some training for the younger people now right out of college in some of the skills that they may need to take on, some pointed skill identification of some of those young, really young, brightest and best would be helpful. In conclusion, I just have a couple of thoughts. One is that this discussion is just beginning. I mean, what I did, I talked to, 24 people, I talked to a lot of other people informally. I feel it's just brushing the surface, frankly, that there's a greater discussion to be had. I would love to see the Alliance, the Lincoln Institute, universities, whatever the proper forum is, sort of continue this discussion because I think it's, what I've done is just open the doors, I hope. But broader discussions would certainly uncover many additional ideas, both about what emerging leaders would like to learn and how that knowledge could be transmitted. And hopefully it would lead to some really concrete action items. The other closing thought I have is that there's a culture in the land trust movement that was instilled early and hasn't really changed. I mean, we can't predict what another 35 years are going to bring. We can try, but we'll be wrong about some things. But we can be pretty sure a lot of change is ahead. But the concerns of land trust leaders in 1981, some of those are entirely recognizable today. they just play out in different ways with more sophisticated methods and results. But over the years, a unique climate culture has been the backbone, I think, of land trust's success. It's a culture of sharing, of respect for grassroots entrepreneurship, of ongoing learning and advancement, of producing tangible conservation results. With care, that culture will continue to foster success, I think, even as land trusts and land conservation continues to evolve, and especially as new generations of leaders infuse the land trust movement with new energy, new skills, and ever forward thinking. It's going to be an exciting time. Thank you.
One of the topics which did not come up in your discussions was climate change.
Mm-hmm.
And the question is, thank you, Ed.
What's the impact of climate change on the next generation of leaders? How do you think they should be prepared to deal with it? What are the consequences that you see ahead?
Well, it was very interesting to me that climate change did not come up. It came up once. One emerging leader said, well, you know, we're beginning to look at our conservation easements a little differently because of climate change. And this was somebody in a coastal area. But generally, it didn't come up as one of the big challenges ahead. I thought about this and why it didn't. I footnoted it in my report. I think partly because it's such a big problem and such a big issue that day to day, this is not high on any individual's to-do list for the day or for the next year or for the next 5 years. It's so hard for one organization or one individual, as we know, to think we can make a major impact on this global problem. But that's not to say that land trusts aren't doing things about it. And the Land Trust Alliance, I know, is helping them to think about how they can make a difference in just what they're doing. Now, you know, there are land trusts that are thinking about what lands they protect and what may happen, especially, again, in coastal areas, perhaps, beginning to choose the land that they protect based on, this land may be inundated, you know, or have big problems. We ought to protect it so it doesn't get developed. There are certainly land trusts that are thinking about connectivity so that critters have a place to move from one place to the other as they plan what kind of resources to deploy and how to deploy them. So it's not, I think, that it's not on people's radar screens. It's just that if you ask what are your big challenges, fundraising comes up, you know, the sort of the mundane, more mundane things. And I think it's in the background. I think it's in the background and rising.
Great. Questions from right there.
Yes, two things. In response to what you just said, this Thursday evening, our local land trust is having a guest speaker talking about climate change and land conservation. Krista Collins will also be speaking on what we're doing locally about this issue. So some of us, and we're not coastal either.
Mm-hmm.
So anyone interested, talk to me afterwards. In all of your interviews, did you speak with any non-staffed, unpaid, volunteer land trust operatives?
I did not, and that was a deliberate choice because I wanted to limit, you know, I could have interviewed 377 people for this project, and I limited it deliberately. But I served 5 years on the Accreditation Commission, where we accredited some all-volunteer land trusts. And I know the Land Trust Alliance is paying quite a lot of attention to, and deservedly so, to those hundreds of land trusts that don't have any staffs. And they are contributing. They may not contribute the most acres, but they're in their communities. They're making huge contributions. So I think they're getting attention. I just chose to limit this for my own sanity, maybe. but that's not a statement by me.
We're dealing with the same issues, and so to hear that the big staffed folks are struggling with those. It's good to hear.
Yeah, well, that's interesting.
In Massachusetts, we do use AmeriCorps, so we have MassLift. So that's been a very positive impact of bringing the next crop of professionals up the ranks.
I'm gonna call on the next gentleman here who will be in this hot seat a year from today.
give or take.
But let me ask everyone who asks a question to identify themselves before they ask their question.
Thanks, Jim. Steve Small. I think one of the most important things in your presentation, which you lay the groundwork for, but said we've got to do more about this, is tapping the experience of the older generation and somehow finding a more formal way to bring together the people with 25, 30 plus years of experience with the new generation of leaders, just on its own. But the climate change question led me to another related observation about that, and it's one of the points that I've been harping on. We've done wonders over the past 30 years with conservation easements, but when I step back and look, I say, the toolbox is too small. We need more ways to save land and new techniques, and you know, this isn't the place for that discussion, but that's one place where I think the exchange of ideas between experienced and younger people could really help to pay off.
Yeah, I do too, and that certainly goes along with the conservation easements are a time bomb. Some land trusts also are looking, beginning to look ahead to the time when they will have protected most of the land in their particular region that's protectable, and they will become just a stewardship, not just because it's huge, but it's not as sexy, a stewardship organization, and are looking ahead as to how they will make a difference and how they can contribute land conservation skills and use them in new directions. And certainly, land trusts are looking, I think, at, especially if they're looking at serving a broader community, are looking at other ways besides easements to do that, because easements are terrific and they do benefit everybody in a general sense, but they're looking at best pocket parks, they're looking at relationships with schools, they're looking at relationships with churches, they're looking at relationships with healthcare, and I think those will bring up more opportunities.
I'm also thinking about new ways to bring significant amounts of investment capital into land conservation, but with different commodities, environmental commodities. We've been thinking about extinguishing development rights with conservation easements, and there's a whole package of stuff out there that someday might be marketable. So, great.
There are certainly people exploring that. The Conservation Finance Network is doing a good job, and I know the Land Trust Alliance is looking at some of those. I think that's coming. It didn't come up very much in my discussions, but it fits right in.
Okay, Gene, we have a question right here. Gentleman in beret.
Surely. Bill Shelton. Gene, in one of your slides, the slide that was on what's happening today, you had greater emphasis on community. And then you had another slide that you called achieving, or rather, defining community conservation. And my question is, one, what is community? Two, can you state a goal or two that captures what you're talking about? And can you recommend any policies that would achieve that goal?
I heard this discussion over and over. What is community conservation? I guess, and the Land Trust Alliance has thought a lot about this, I know, so maybe Laura can provide the answer better than I can, but what I heard was the idea that not so much community conservation is A, B, C, D, as we need to figure out how to make what we're doing more relevant to segments of our community that have not traditionally either been active in conservation or cared about conservation or thought they cared about it. And it takes many forms, I've found. It might be a trails project that opens up for an organization that's just only done conservation easements on agricultural land, and they don't suddenly, but they decide to do a trails project so that more people can use their land. It might be a community garden project for an organization that has never done that to bring other segments of the community onto their land. One land trust is working with a major city to develop a recreational plan for the city. This may involve the land trust protecting land, but it's using its skills. Others are trying to find out what conservation, what land protection means and how people use land, and they're finding out that not everybody uses it the same way, and that in some cases communities of color big family picnics are a big deal on some open space for some cultures. Or fishing in an urban setting might be a big issue that they never thought about before. Things like this. So I'm not answering your question because I think it's still a struggle. That's why I put it up as a challenge. Some land trusts are worried about mission creep. Some land trusts are trying to figure out, does it mean less actual land protection of acres and more of something else? That's why it's a challenge, and that's why it's going to play out very strongly and interestingly in the next 5 or 10 years, I think.
Sir.
Joe Beckman from Somerville. I have two questions. One is, do you consider the land banks on Martha's Vineyard and Nantucket to be land trusts or land banks, and is there a distinction? That's the first question. The second one is, what about urban land trusts? You haven't really focused on them at all.
Your first question, I think they go hand in hand. Land banking is a way of protecting land. So I personally would not necessarily make a big distinction between a land trust and a land bank. It's a tool for protecting land.
Except that it has an income.
Yeah, well, yes, that helps. That's a big difference. I did interview urban land trusts. I interviewed a wonderful woman who's running a land trust in downtown Los Angeles. I interviewed other land trusts, a young woman, and she taught me a lot about the kinds of skills she's looking for. They are doing urban parks and small parks and working a lot with communities of color and people. They have a translator that they use when they go to public meetings. I mean, this is on the edge for most land trusts now, but I wanted to talk to her. She was great. And other land trusts I talked to are working in cities as part of what they do in urban areas. Not all of what they do, but part of it. So yeah, this is happening.
Do we have time for one more question? And I'm going to take that opportunity. I don't see any hands shooting up right now. The successor to your successor has just taken on leadership at the Land Trust Alliance. Mm-hmm. Andrew Bowman has succeeded Rand Wentworth as president of the Land Trust Alliance. There will be an opportunity, I'm sure, where you're sitting at a table together at an event where Andrew says, Gene, what advice do you have for me? So what advice would you offer this brand new leader of the national movement?
That's a good question. I guess, in a nutshell and in a very succinct way, because I would probably have hours worth of things to pass on, whether he wanted me to or not. But a great choice, by the way, Andrew Bowman. But I guess I would go back to this culture of land trusts that I think has made land trusts so successful. And even as the change has come, and you have to be really open to those, that new energy, the new world around us, the new ways of doing things, more professionalism, I think the single thing that identifies the land trust, or characterizes the land trust movement, is this culture of sharing, of learning, constant learning, of helping each other. If this land trust succeed, I feel good about it because that helps me succeed. And the care and that culture that has been there from the very beginning, when the Land Trust Exchange was just a loose collection of organizations that thought they were land trusts. To this very day, it is, I think it permeates still. You see it at the rally, you see it in workshops, you see it in land trusts coming together to change policy, to make tax laws better. It's very important, the lack of competitiveness among the land trusts. I would tell him, or hope, urge him to make sure that that culture continues.
I want to ask you to join me in thanking Gene for a very nice presentation, a very thoughtful presentation, and for your continued leadership in our infrastructure.